Awesome. Okay, guys, can I start? So yeah, today I just want to introduce Gradle. So as you all know, I know nothing about it, so it's gonna be funny. I have used it for personal projects, and I found it very interesting. Okay, wait. So the plan for today, what is Gradle? Then we'll talk about how to do dependency management with it, because it's a bit the purpose of Gradle. How are tasks working with Gradle, and how you can use it for testing and customize it. So it's really an introduction. We could go a lot more in depth, but maybe not today. So what is Gradle? By the way, if you guys have questions, ask. Don't wait for the end, ask now, okay? So Gradle is a tool where you build by convention. It's on a Groovy DSL, can also be Kotlin. It supports dependencies from Maven and Ivy, or Ivy, whatever you want. You can support multi-projects build, and it's a declarative language. It means that you express what you want, not how you want it. So support multi-projects builds, it's like Maven. Support dependencies from Maven or Ivy, so from Maven, it's like Maven. And build by convention is different from Maven because it's by configuration from Maven. Okay? So Gradle, usually you have a build.gradle in your project. Build.gradle is a build file. When you have a multi-module project, you now have a settings.gradle and a few build.gradles per module. So this is why sometimes when you generate automatically a project, it has a settings.gradle and a build.gradle. Okay? In this file, you find plugins, tasks, dependencies. So I'm going to go on each of these things later. And you also have the Gradle wrapper. Gradle wrapper is a task by itself. So I'm going to explain what it is. But also to standardize your project on a given version. So let's say that right now, I set up a project with Gradle 3.2. Build the task Gradle wrapper, and it's gonna download Gradle with this version for our projects with a script Gradle W to then for everybody use the same script, the same version of Gradle and our CI to use this. Now that if we have other version of Gradle set up somewhere else on the CI or on our machines, by using Gradle W, it's gonna always work the same for everybody. So yeah, it's provisioning a new Gradle version to different users and execution environment by just changing the wrapper and commit it. So this is something that you put on Git. Okay? All good? Yep. Next topic. Okay. So dependency management. So you can have several kind of repositories. You mentioned them in your in the part repositories. You can have the Maven local, Maven central, JCenter. Or you can also say, I have a Maven on a special URL, or an Ivy on a special URL, and you can pass the Artifactory of your company in it, the URL, and it can work like that too. Or you can also, for instance, on the project we have put on the skeleton in the templates, we use Maven Central and JCenter because the library of test of Kotlin, Spech, is in JCenter but not in Maven Central. Okay? So, how do you declare your dependencies? You can have them written in different ways. So, what I try to show here is that you can put a list with just commas, single colon, and you can put the group, the name, and the version separated by colons, and have a list without putting an array. Or you can have group, semicolon, the group, name, semicolon, the name, and the version. And you can also say, oh, I want, like in this example, I want to use Spring Boot Starter test, but I don't want to take JUnit and Mockito because, for instance, what I'm using is JUnit 5 in my project. So I don't need these two libraries. So don't put them in my build. Okay? Dependencies are transitive. Often you see when you do your tree of dependencies on Maven or Gradle, you see plenty of stuff, but it doesn't have to always happen. You can classify it as transitive false, and it might not be the case. Of course, there are other properties, but I haven't put them. What you see in front of your dependencies, implementation, test implementation, and so on, you have a test compile, you have compile, you have a runtime. These classifications depend on the plugin you use. So usually, to use a special language, you're gonna use a plugin. To use a language, and for instance, using Spring, you're gonna use another plugin. And you're gonna have different kind of dependencies for each, depending on the plugins you have. Okay? So this is to look into the documentation. So I put here Gradle-Q dependencies because I think it's a command that can be really useful. It allows you to see all the dependencies per classification. For instance, for test implementation here, we're gonna see Spring Framework boot test, starter test, or JUnit Jupyter. We're gonna see that for implementation, we have a Kotlin stdlib JDK8, and you're gonna see all the sub dependencies. And if we put the dash configuration, test implementation is gonna give us all the dependencies that we use for test implementation. So this is quite a nice command. In Maven, you'd probably do Maven tree. In SBT, you'd probably have a plugin to be able to do SBT tree. So this is out of the box. Quite nice.
Nico, one question.
Yes.
Could you come back to the transitive false? Because I didn't quite get it. So you mentioned that you can list the number of
Yeah, for instance,
dependencies.
here in that case, we have JUnit and Mockito. Let's say that I don't put my test implementation JUnit Jupyter, and I put transitive true. I let it like that.
Oh, so you just
So it means that the JUnit I can have can come from the Spring Boot Starter test.
I see what
You see what I
you mean.
mean?
Okay, just a source. It's
Yeah,
actually a source.
because it's already embedded in this jar. Okay? There are some subtleties, but I'm not completely very familiar with it. But there are other.
And the second question is, do you remember in older versions, they were using compile instead of implementation? Sometimes,
That's true.
do you know what's the difference
So
between
it depends on your plugin. I found it, and I don't remember. But there is an API, there is implementation, there is runtime, there is a compile, there is test compile. But here in this example, I didn't put everything. But yes, on Java plugin or on Kotlin plugin, you have all of this. Okay? Can look into it in more detail later, but since it was
It's
just an
deprecated.
introduction, I just didn't want
Yeah, they said that implementation is preferred, so.
to. Yeah. So what is the task in Gradle? Tasks are code that is executed by Gradle. So since Gradle, the example I show you is using Groovy DSL, it's Groovy code. So it has lifecycle, properties, actions. Actions are usually closures, do last, do first. It can have dependencies, and it can have types. I can say, oh, I want to create a task of a type test. But this is for later. No spoilers, but it's for later. So here on the right, I define a task A because I don't have imagination. I have a description. This is the A class. I have the do first. It's a closure. It can take an object. It can take a function. It can take this. println do first closure of A class. It can have a do last. It can have several do first, it can have several do last closures. And then we have the B class, task B. I don't know why I call it B class, by the way, but yeah, I probably wanted to write B task, but yeah, whatever. Same, it has do first and do last. But you see, these are actions. It has a property that is description, and it also has the dependency with the A task, which means that if I do run on my B task, it's gonna run the A task before. Before, yes. Okay.
Nico, one more question. So if you put, let's say you mentioned two do first and two do last, is it going to execute both asynchronous or one by one, the one that you put?
I think it's one by one.
One by one.
And the trick is that, for instance, if after B task B, I go in the script and I put a task dot do first, and I put a println another closure, it might execute the other one before this one. Okay? It takes the overloaded closure first and then the first one.
Okay.
I don't know if it made sense, but when I tested, I always had that.
Okay?
So, this is okay. Don't be too hard. yes. So here we have several tasks. We have A task that has a closure. We have a AA task. We have the C task. We have the D task and the B task. My goal with this was to show you that we have several tasks. But the B task has a dependency on A task here, and a dependency on AA double A task. And it must, there is a property here that is maybe not very easy to read. It must run after C task and must be finalized by D task. I'm gonna send you the PowerPoint, don't worry guys. So this is to show that I can have a task that depends on several tasks. And that must, to be finished, it needs to have another task that runs after it. Okay?
So if the first task fails, all of those that depend on this task, they are aborted.
Yeah, it's aborted. Yeah, exactly. So if I run B task, you end up with the result on the right. First, it's gonna, you see? What I was telling you, at the end of the script of the Gradle file, we have B task depends on A task, and then B task depends on double A task. So it's going to execute first double A task. Then it executes A task. It executes the B task, and since it must finish by D task, the last task running is the D task. There is a property must run after C task. So this is to say, when I run my Gradle script, in all the tasks of my Gradle script, the C class must be before the B task.
If it runs.
But it's when we do the whole script. But not necessarily AA. Well, not necessarily those two ones. Okay? So I admit that the example println stuff might not make a lot of sense, but if you want to do some builds, have stuff that run depending on other stuff, and it can be convenient. Questions? Okay. Oops. So another nice thing is that if you want to get the list of tasks that you have, you have to type Gradle tasks. The list of tasks depend on the plugin you have. And you're gonna see that Gradle build, for instance, will run Gradle test and Gradle check. So if you look at the code source of Gradle build, of the build task, it's gonna show that it depends on check, and check depends on test. So this is a good example on how they use the task themselves. So now we have seen dependencies, we have seen tasks. the testing. So that's what I was saying. Gradle build runs the test, so it depends on Gradle test. Sorry.
How does it know what
test? So test is a default task that can be overloaded, and it's gonna run with into the test package.
How does it know when it's not
packaged? You don't have to.
Does it use the Maven layout?
Yes, use by default this one, but you can specify another source set and another resource set, another test set.
But
if
by
you
default, the default thing says
exactly.
Layout.
Yes. Yeah. My goal was to also provide you a few command lines. So for instance, if you want to run only one class of test, you can type Gradle test, blah, blah, blah. If you want to run only one unit test, you can do that. Honestly, I don't think it's very useful, but some people do it, so why not? When you have a Maven project, usually you have a target folder once you have run your Maven task. Here, it's a build folder. And if you want to find your test, you need to go into reports/test. By default, when you run Gradle test, you have an HTML report in it. So you can find an index.html that's gonna give you the report of all your tests. So here, in the test, so let's look at the first part, test. I tell him, use GUnit platform, which means I want him to use the GUnit test of Jupyter, of GUnit 5. But I also tell him, exclude this class, legacy test.class, because maybe in our CI/CD, we don't want to run the legacy test. I don't know who would do that, but anyway. Now, I can create my own task, which is quit test. And I embed the test task. So let's say I don't have the test task, but I have quit test. This one, we use GUnit platform, and it's going to include, you know, with GUnit platform, it's GUnit 5. So you can put tags on your unit test. I can say run only the tags that are fast and exclude the tags that are slow. So you can customize which unit test you want to run with GUnit 5. So this is an annotation you put on your unit test when you write your test. And it's a feature of GUnit 5. Okay? Now let's say that I want to have an integration test task. Because maybe I want my test to run when I do Gradle test, but I don't want my integration test to run, so I put my integration test in another folder. Let's say I called it what I put there, int test. So I create a task, integration test, of type test. I provide the test class dirs. I provide the class path that you were asking me before, Lyman. I can say, so this is where you're gonna find your test. And this should run after test. So I mean that when I'm gonna run the script, the Gradle integration test, first it's gonna run Gradle test, and then it's gonna run integration test. So this, for instance, can be interesting when you have a CI/CD, you start to have a big project, and let's say that you have unit test, component test, integration test, and regression test, I don't know, whatever. And maybe you want to run your integration test only when you create your merge request. In your CI/CD, if you have a task regression test, you can manage to run only this one at this moment. And I can also say, you see check, Gradle check is a task that is proper to a plugin. I can overload it with integration test. So it means that I say check will also depend on integration test. So here it's a simple example, but I could do that only when I'm in my CI/CD, when I want to merge a branch. And by doing so, I can pass properties to my Gradle command. and be like, if CLI has property CI/CD, then shell dot depends integration test. This is something I could do in my Gradle script.
Is the source set in test is built-in in Gradle, or do you have to add your own source test?
Good question.
Sorry, can you repeat?
So the source set in test,
mm-hmm.
Is it built-in in Gradle? You have like the source source set, you have the test source set. Is this source set built-in, or you have to define your own source set to
separate? I think you have to define it beforehand.
Yeah, you need to define.
Okay, it's not
there. Yeah,
so but
source set is something that you're gonna define in a variable before, and it can take by default like in Maven, and it can be something else. You can say in my project source set is gonna be something else. Okay. Yeah, I didn't want to enter in these details because you can easily use.
Something you need to add on top of this
project. Yeah, so source sets are built in, but you can modify them to make them do what you want. Okay. And so yeah, this was my introduction on Gradle. So if you just do dependency, it doesn't bring a lot of value compared to Maven, except that it's code, it's a convention, it's not XML. You can even do it in Kotlin. I find it clearer in Groovy, even though I don't really like Groovy, but anyway. Do you have questions?
Yes, one more question. So let's say if you build the jar, I faced a couple of issues when I wanted to build the fed jar with the libraries. So in my case, for building of the fed jar, I use like third-party library. So you never faced any problems to build some fed jar with dependencies, or?
I never tried. So you have a task. I think it's a boot jar or something like that.
Yeah.
So wait, let me put my.
Exactly. Yes, Uber jar.
Yeah,
Uber jar. I think
yeah.
that's what I'm
going to
have.
Yeah. Uber jar. Yeah. Okay. And depending on the plugin you use, they provide you a task for that usually.
Mm-hmm.
Like for Kotlin, Java, and Spring Boot, they provide also the task that should do that.
Okay.
I haven't tested it, but I've seen the task.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I use the Uber jar. Okay. Ah, and by the way, do you know any information of the benchmarking? Like, for instance, is the Gradle faster than?
I don't know.
Okay. It's a benefit. I mean,
like, I can say that on my on the window on my finger, I find it a lot quicker, a lot faster than SBT. But but it's SBT, right?
It's SBT, yeah.
So, but otherwise, I don't know. Do you guys have questions on the call?
Can you write plain Java in a Gradle
file? No. But you can write Kotlin. Why would you want to write?
Oh, I mean, you can write. I heard that actually you can literally write Java code in the Groovy file. Like you can just
regular
do Java
Groovy.
There.
Yeah, I don't know about Gradle.
You can just do system out print line and then put some logic there.
Okay. Well, if there are no questions, I'm going to stop presenting. All good?
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Bye.